quality here.
Yes. Yes. Woo!
Wow, 21. You're 21? I was just learning how to tune the guitar, 21. That's what's clever about the We Are Family Foundation is the gift is not just to see the future, but to find those who build the future. And that's I think what's touching me and a lot of us as we see these incredible teenagers. And I formed you too. We formed you two when we were your age, and I just feel a real connection with you guys tonight. Up the GTL. I came across Niall Rogers' prophetic utterances in the Paradise Garage here in New York in the 80s, where We Are Family was being played as a defiant anthem for AIDS activists. Long before One and Red were here.
Yeah!
This tune meant so much to this community here in the city. And what I loved about Niall was that Niall Rogers created with his words a world that he didn't live in, but he wanted to. His family had some tough times, so he wrote We Are Family. He lived through some bad times, so he wrote Good Times. Niall turned his abandoned love into a demand. I want your love. I need your love. In that sense, he stepped into his words, as we all do, good or bad. But I want to thank you, Niall, for having a vision big enough to include us all. Now, President Carter, what was that? What was that?
That's
a presentation. And I will say, as a young man growing up in Ireland, in the Troubles, as they were called, the war in Ireland was called the Troubles. As a teenager, I began to hear a lot about this poetic figure who was running for president in the United States. He quoted Bob Dylan, who wasn't, at that time, my actual president of the United States, my United States. He campaigned for the Allman Brothers. You got the feeling if his hair was just a little longer, he'd be in the Allman Brothers. But this was the first world leader I ever heard who knew the words to all the songs that were my generation's telegraph. Mr. Carter understood that those songs expressed the yearning not just of Americans, but the hunger of the whole world to be free of the old vocabulary of Cold War and Hot War and victory parades, the power of nations reckoned only by the size of their armies and the destructive potential of their weapons. He just presented a whole different way of thinking about American power. He made human rights a national mandate. He counted his successes not by the wars he waged, but by the peace he made possible.
Yes!
Who could forget that photograph on the White House lawn, clasping the hands of Anwar Sadat and Menachem Begin? And it just sends a signal of what's possible in today's strife-ridden world. What a special feeling to have him in the room. President Carter, it's worth remembering, put the lives of American hostages in Iran ahead of his own re-election.
Woo!
It's a true measure of his greatness in his heart. 35 years, President Carter's continued to champion peace and improve public health through the Carter Center. And people realized that President Carter was not kidding and that peace was not just a pretty word to him. They asked him, where did he get his moral compass from? He didn't cite an academic text. He didn't quote an economist or a philosopher or a pollster or a pundit or even Bob Dylan. He cited the Holy Scriptures. And in my late teens, this meant a lot to me, and it still does. The most powerful man in the world humbled himself to submit to a higher power. And in doing that, he put himself in an extraordinary tradition of great heroes of peace. Bobby Kennedy, Mother Teresa,